Hello everybody, welcome to the Humans Over Numbers podcast, the show that's willing to stand on its head to see the workplace from a new perspective.
This episode is going to be brought to you and sponsored by Milestones. They make the Beyond This Day, Small Wonders, and a couple of other employee keepsake gifts to recognize major events for your employees. So if you guys want, they offer free samples over at their website, milestonescompany.com. You can go request one for yourself and review what kind of impact it can make on your team.
I'm Felix Duceblon, hungry bookworm and aspiring polymath.
I am Brooke Albert. I'm a new mommy and a self-proclaimed nerd.
So we're here to talk about finding meaning in the workplace. And to kick us off with this discussion, we sort of pulled up an article and read it and just started thinking about it. And the question it asks, are millennials more likely to want purpose in the workplace? Or not, it's not a question, that part. It's they are more likely to want meaning, but they're not finding it. So let's talk about that briefly. Why might that be the case? Is that actually something that's true? Is this a study that's showing something that's legitimate phenomenon?
It was a really interesting article. It was on The Guardian, and it basically said that older employees are more likely to find purpose in their work. And then the generation below that would be kind of in the middle. And then the millennials were behind that. And they took three different categories of what people are looking like in their professional lives. And I think they used LinkedIn to contact everyone. And the millennials were the lowest in purpose being their number one thing for their careers, for their workplace, whatever, what they were looking for. Millennials, mostly from what they could tell, and there was a lot of assumptions and extrapolation from all of the information they got, was that millennials are more focused on getting a house, getting their career started, maybe finding a partner to be with. This traditional, like, get your life set up, and then you can worry about, what I would think is what your legacy is going to be. Because it seems like the older you get, the more you start to worry or think about what kind of impact you've left, what kind of legacy that you have, what did you do with your time on Earth? Which is why the older generation is more likely to try to find meaning in what they do, while the younger generation is still just trying to figure life out.
Oh.
Anyway.
That's interesting. That's actually, that's the opposite of what I was thinking and I would have thought. Because I know a lot of younger generations, my generation, there's a lot of people telling you that you have meaning or that you find your meaning, that there's a purpose in what you do and to find that purpose. And so I thought that was an idea that's more generational. We're seeing a lot more now.
I think the reason for that is really interesting is Simon Sinek's focus on the why.
Why? Yeah.
Came out. I mean, so not everybody that's around that time. I don't think Simon Sinek is considered a millennial. I think he's more like the present age. And I think there's 7 years there. But I think that's wise because we came out after that. So we're coming into this workspace at the time that blew up and was taking everywhere. And if you work in a sales organization or if you're going to read this book, it's supposed to, help you kind of focus on the why, and that's where that whole meaning comes, because it's like, why are you doing it? What is the purpose?
Okay.
And people just kind of ran with it.
I think either way, personally, I feel like I need to find purpose, and I need to find it a lot. But with me, or at least this begins asking a question of me looking for it, is it something I even should be looking for? Or is it just like us being entitled? Because work is work. And it's what you used as the means to facilitate the rest of your life. Should we be happy that it's that? Or do we need to make it have more meaning? Or should it have more meaning?
It's a really good question. And I think, there are, I think, two, maybe three kinds of working people. You've got the people who live paycheck to paycheck, working three jobs. And then you've got the people who are kind of, their basic needs are met with their job. Right. And then you got the people who do kind of have that luxury to, I can pick and choose which company to work for, which job I accept based on the kind of satisfaction that work gives me.
Okay.
So it is a bit of a luxury to look into that, but I think it's necessary to remind yourself that there's meaning in your work, even if you don't find your work meaningful, as in, like, the impact that you make doing your job. It's still meaningful because of what it gives you, and I think that'll return happiness so you're not as miserable working.
Okay, so you're saying our meaning in our work is actually because it facilitates the rest of our lives.
Yeah, well, because, you know, sometimes, like, okay, not everybody is going to be Greta Thunberg, right?
Mm-hmm.
Who is doing so much work. Or the Pope. Not everybody's going to be the Pope, right? Mm-hmm. Or, you know, there's just...
Right, it's not everyone gets their job to be their vocation, right?
Right.
Many people, kids want to be like doctors, and only a few people grow up to be doctors.
Right, or they want to grow up to be a fireman and save people. And even if your job isn't that impactful on society, where you're saving someone's life or providing these charitable things, or, you know what I mean, you still make an impact on your job because of what it facilitates you to do as a person. So provide for your kids or your partner, or... even getting to enjoy your hobbies and to be a happy person. Like, if we want to go camping for a weekend, can we afford to do that? Well, if I work my job and my job allows me to go do that, I should be grateful and find meaning in my job because it facilitates that kind of lifestyle.
Okay. See, I'm thinking of this sort of the other perspective, like the Chinese proverb, choose a job you love and you will never work a day in your life. And I think you're right that it's kind of a luxury for people to get a job that they love. Most people don't have a job they love. Most people have a job that works.
So if you look in today's world, we've got people who, like, Twitch streamers or YouTubers who are doing hobbies they love. It's now become a job. Mm-hmm. And suddenly that their hobby that they used to escape from the real world, to wind down, to enjoy themselves, is something they have to do every day for money to facilitate the kind of lifestyle they want. So even if I enjoy playing video games, if I had to play video games for a living and was doing it 60 plus hours a week, I am no longer going to enjoy that.
You don't think you would?
No. I would be so tired. I would get to the point where I would want to play, like, the old space arcade pinball machine on Microsoft Windows.
Yeah, just to
take
that game.
Yeah, just to take a step back from all the heavy video gaming I would be doing and the editing and all the stuff that goes into it. So now this thing that I really loved has kind of become a burden. Well, I don't like that. I don't think that proverb's very good.
Okay. I feel like it is, though. I feel like if you have a job that you really do enjoy a lot, it is something meaningful. But that also makes it another question, though. Is that actually a meaningful job? Because, like, okay, here's a quote from a economist. His name is Arthur Brooke. He said, the greatest engine of misery in our society is a sense of social and economic superfluousness. There you go. I got it the second time. And wouldn't we actually describe all entertainment jobs as superfluous? Like, that's literally what an entertainment job does. So if you're working as a streamer or an actor or something, your job by nature is superfluous. But he's saying that's the symptom of misery. And you're saying that it doesn't matter what your job is, it's going to feel miserable. But I'm wondering how that plays a part into this. Because, like, that's like, I don't know. Right now there's, like, a couple warring ideas in my head. Because I think I agree with you in the, we should try to find some meaning with jobs regardless of whether we get to enjoy them. And I'm not sure I'm on board with you in the point that whatever we do, we're going to end up disliking it because that's our job. And so it loses some of its wonder. I think I think back to actually a job that I really liked. I mean, I didn't do it for very long. So maybe if I was still doing it, I would hate it. But when I was younger, I worked in some hog barns, and I worked a lot of weird jobs when I was younger. But one of them, this one, I really liked. There were two sets of hog barn working experience I did. One I hated and one I liked. The one I really liked was, I got these things. They're called cutting boards. They're like large plastic sheets. And we were giving the pigs vaccinations. Mm-hmm. And we were doing some vaccine trials on the pigs, and I was working for a vaccine company. And what they would do is this doesn't harm the pig at all. They would go in, and one of the people would spray paint the backs of the pigs pink and blue to mark their gender. And then I went in with my brother, and both of us with these big plastic boards, and they would just call out what color they wanted. And there was just a swarm of pigs, including ones that didn't have any paint on them. And we'd have to, like, shuffle around to, like, maneuver them to run towards the door. And so we were like getting in their way and moving, and it became pinball with pigs. Mm-hmm. And so my brother and I still refer to that job as pigball. We got to play pigball for we were paid to do pigball, and I was like, this is the best job of my entire life. And so you're saying if I did that every day, I'd be bored of it. But I'm like, I don't know if I would. I did it for multiple days, and I was thoroughly enjoying myself.
Well, I have a few. When I was in high school, I did a research paper. My school required that in our junior and senior year, we would interview people who had professions we were interested in. Mm-hmm. And we would write research papers based off of that. And the gentleman I interviewed was an electrical engineer. And he told me that you don't find a job you love and you'll love it. He'd been doing it for 30 years and he hated it.
That's funny.
And you did that for a couple of days and you're like, I don't know if I would have hated it by the end of the summer or the year, right? I did decon work at nuclear power plants and I loved it. Mm. Loved that job, right? But that's also possibly because I only did it 8 weeks at a time. And then I would get like a 2-month break. And then I'd go back to work for 8 weeks at a time and then take a break. So it's not constant. I feel like repetitiveness plays a part in that, maybe. If you're doing some kind of task the same every day with very little variation, eventually you're going to get annoyed and bored with it.
That's actually a great question for anyone listening then. Is have you found a job that you love that no matter how many times you do it, it never gets old? Because the guy I was working for when I was doing the pigball, he was like, yeah, this pays the bills. And I was like, this is the best thing ever. Why would you? Why do you have that attitude? Like, you get to play like the thing where they do at fairs where like the pigs are slicked down, you have to catch it. You get to do that every day.
Grease the pig, yeah.
And, but it's, nope, it's not a fun thing for him. So I think for any of these though, whether it's a job that gets boring or a job that doesn't, I think we can still try to find the work as our mission and make ourselves really good at it. And we might be able to find purpose that way. There's a really great MLK quote. This is like my favorite MLK quote. And this quote, I think, really highlights that idea that it doesn't matter if it's a job that you're just sort of doing to facilitate your work, you can still be great at it. The quote goes as follows. If a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should be sweet. Whoa. Okay, that's a lot of S sounds. If a man is called to be a street sweeper, he should sweep streets even as Michelangelo painted or Beethoven composed music or Shakespeare wrote poetry. He should sweep streets so well that all the hosts of heaven and earth will pause and say, here lived a great sweeper who did his job well.
I think that's a little different. So if you always take pride in your work, regardless, okay, is not the same thing as having meaning in your work. I think they are associated and closely related. I do not think they are the same thing. I worked in college as a sandwich maker, right? Okay. I worked at a food chain, and I took pride in what I did. And I always, any job I've ever had, I always tried to be the best I could at it. Mm-hmm. It's an unfortunate side effect of being a perfectionist. I always want to be perfect at it. I didn't find meaning in that work. You know, going in during the day, there wasn't a purpose to that, if that makes sense. There wasn't a whole lot of satisfaction or happiness that came with that job until I started to say, you know what, this is helping me support my mom. It's helping me support me. It's getting me from point A to point B in my car by paying my bills and my gas money. And so when I started to look at it that way, I was like, okay, this isn't a bad job because I'm able to do these things because I have this job, and that's awesome, you know?
That makes me think, I had a friend who, that was his perspective. He's like, man, once you start earning money and you can like spend on things you like, it's like, I don't care what I'm doing. Like, this is awesome that I can buy things I like with money now. And so I think there's some point that, I don't know, there's sort of in the opposite though. And maybe it agrees with you. There's like, it's like in a TV show, Monk, I don't know if you ever watched it. It's, yeah, like the detective Monk one. Okay, mm-hmm. I love it. But there was like one really weird episode where he goes, so Monk hates all germs and everything, but at one point he's got to go to the bathroom really bad. And so he goes to what he thinks is a public bathroom in like a, it's not a opera house. I think they were watching a play or something, but it's attached to a theater. And so he's like, oh no, this is going to be horrible. He walks in and it's immaculate. And there's a guy in there. And the guy is like just really into making sure the bathroom is like a perfect place, and he's got like all these soaps lined out, and it's spick and span, it's clean, it looks like it's like a palace in there, and it was just like, what on earth? Mm-hmm. And he had a conversation with the guy, and the guy told him, there are no small jobs, only small people. And it makes you wonder about like people who like take full advantage of their job, either because they think I am doing this job, therefore it is worth my time, or they're thinking that this job, it's never below us to do the best we can, right? So
yeah,
we have a responsibility to do the best we can. If you don't, you're being a small person, and not that you were given a small job. No task is small. All tasks are important. It's got that sort of idea behind it.
Well, it's like always do your best.
Yeah. And right? I think the quote, the MLK quote, was pushing to the same effect. It was, do your best always. And it doesn't matter if you're a street sweeper or you're a bathroom cleaner and monk, right? You can always do an amazing job, so much that the heavens and earths can look down at you and say, there lived a great sweeper.
Yeah. Yeah. But, so when it comes to finding meaning at work, I think there's, like, a couple of ways to do it. I think you can look at it, at what it gives you, either internally in a sense of satisfaction, or materialistically, what it allows you to do. But it's like, how do you get there? Do you have to find a company that's doing, like, do you look for external things, like, what I do is helping the world, or because like currently, like do you need to work for a company where you agree with its like mission statement and its purpose, and can you find meaning that way?
Okay, that's I think that's a good question. I'm wondering, obviously, I was thinking about this because when sort of started talking about the topic and I started looking into it and thinking about it before we started filming, I thought about the fact that, and you alluded to this earlier as well, that there are people who get jobs that are really meaningful, right? There are doctors, there are people with service jobs. Service jobs are naturally really meaningful. Whether they're in the medical field or in the military, they feel like they have a lot of meaning there. But for all the other jobs, even if you support the mission of the company, they're not all nonprofits. They're not all doing the great works for the world. They're selling software, selling food, letting people can get consultants. Like they're not great jobs in a lot of ways. So for our meaning, I think we don't need to be looking for the big thing, the big picture. We might want to be looking at something smaller. And I was wondering about like finding meaning in like little moments of your life, in your day, like taking pride and purpose in the little things. And like,
so a really good tie-in for this, I guess, okay, would be our sponsor is Milestones.
Yeah.
Right? And they provide keepsake gifts where the company acknowledges those, they're not necessarily little moments, but they're personal moments to the employee. Mm-hmm. And being a part of that, right? I think one of them, the Beyond This Day, is like a memorial keepsake.
Okay.
Right? So yep. Would the sales representatives have those moments where they interact with Milestone's customers and maybe they get really good feedback? Would that give them purpose?
So that could give them purpose. And I think that's a company that gets lucky in its mission. But even companies that don't have as much mission, where they're selling something like straws. Or if you work for Dunder and Mifflin, the one from The Office, Dunder Mifflin.
Oh, yeah.
And they sell paper, right? They're not going to get someone coming back, wow, thank you for selling me the paper. I just wrote a great novel on this paper, and it's changed people's lives. And that's not going to happen to them, but they can still find little moments. And I'm actually reading a book called The Five Languages of Appreciation in the Workplace, and it's about the five love languages and how to use them to help people on their day-to-day, like improve the company culture and stuff. And I think those are the moments that maybe people need to be looking for. Like the moments that matter aren't necessarily just those huge moments that are recognized by, like, yes, someone died in your family, or you had a baby. You're like, I had a baby earlier this year. It's like, this is a huge moment in my life, right? And getting married. We only have a few of those in our lives. I don't think we need to say our lives are defined by those moments. You know, some people do. I think we need to make our lives mean something and all the other pieces of it too, because there's a whole lot of life that's not those big moments that we need to acknowledge and appreciate. So like when you do something like a task well done, And this one was talking about, like, other people acknowledging it, other people, like, showing that they care that you're there. Mm-hmm. And those are moments that matter. But I think we need to be able to take ownership of small tasks and, like, do our job well and really hone in on who we are and what we're doing. You think? I keep getting the exact same point every single time I go. It doesn't matter what I take, but like the quote or the topic, I always end up at the exact same point.
Well, I think finding meaning at work is super complex, and I think it's necessary. I think everyone needs to find some kind of meaning to support their occupation, their job, whatever you want to call it, mm-hmm. or else we're all super miserable. Because yes. then we're just kind of slaving away to the corporate machine, man, you know, like...
Right. Well, that's the whole office humor is based off that idea that we're super done with being in the corporate machine.
Yeah.
We all hate it.
And COVID-19 this year, if it has done anything, it has shown what work, like, because the whole world kind of got thrown into this upside down, crazy
mm-hmm.
alternate universe. Where, you know, everything's been reversed and it's not the same, and people are starting to see that it's really difficult without the social interaction to and kind of enjoy your job, right? If you're stuck at home working from home, you're going to miss people. I talked to one of my clients and she was like, yeah, I really miss people. She's like, you know, I get up, I go to the living room, I come back to bed. And it's been that way since March for her. And she's like, yeah, I've got my dog, I've got my cat.
Oof.
But it's tough. So finding meaning at work can be so much more than just having a job that saves the world or, you know, the life that it lets you get. It's also the relationships that you make at work where people recognize the little things like you had a really good day. You have mm-hmm. a nice haircut. You look good today. It's your birthday, which it is your birthday. So.
Thank you. Yes, it is.
You know, it's like that kind of thing where it's just, yeah. it's like a little smiley on your heart. Yeah,
well, that's definitely, I mean, all day it's been like little smileys on my heart. I'm like, oh, thank you guys. Oh, thank you.
Wait till the baby's old enough to say happy birthday. That first time's going to get you.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. I do not doubt that. Ooh. All emotional from that. Okay. Well, so I think this is geared towards more of like satisfying yourself in your work. Well, on the HR summer school, there was, I think it was the extra credit hour. There was a guy yeah. who came on, and he, Eric Torgan, I hope I'm saying your name right.
My apologies if you ever hear this and it was not right.
I do actually, I really wish I knew what your name sounded like. But he talked about something really fascinating. And it was this idea that there's like these quadrants. There's four quadrants. If you don't remember what a quadrant is because you don't remember your maths, which is fair. It's like an axis, where like it's the four sections that you break a square up into, right? Do you have an upper left corner, upper right corner, bottom left corner, bottom right corner, right? It's square. And there's the four pieces of the square, right? The four squares in a square. And he talked about that if you, there's this like gradient spectrum along the two sides of jobs that you enjoy doing or things that you enjoy doing, and let's call that up and down, so that's not going to be on the y-axis, yep, and then you're going to have the things that you that other people value, right, and that's your x-axis. And he said most there's different things that are done, like hobbies are really high on the y-axis. In other words, we really enjoy them. But they're very low on the x-axis. So that means they put them up in the left corner, right? Because they're pretty much useless to everybody, but you really like doing them, right? Actually, that's most leisurely activities, right? Watching movies. It's really useless to just about everybody on the planet, but you really like doing it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's that upper quadrant. And then he said there's the menial tasks and work. The things like answering emails and just putting in data.
Taking phone calls,
right? The things that are menial and just bore you to death. The grindstone stuff. That stuff is, that's very high, or that's pretty high on the x-axis, but really low on the y. So it's actually the bottom right corner. Or actually not even the bottom right. It doesn't even... it's not even like super high value. And so he's like, those are the things you're going to need to do for your work. It's like, what you really need to figure out is what you like doing that's valuable to others, and then make sure you can get more and more of that incorporated into your work. So like right now for me, it's podcasting, right? So like in creating stuff, or like writing blogs, I write
articles.
I write articles sometimes, and I like doing that. I start writing an article, I'm like, doo, 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 and then like time flies by and I'm like, I've created something for work and they think it's valuable and I've had a great time. And that's, he said, that's where you want to try putting yourself. Making things that you enjoy that are valuable to your company.
Like for me, it's data.
Data analytics?
Data analytics, data entry, just taking a whole bunch of numbers and a whole bunch of information and arranging it and tracking it and getting stuff from it, I absolutely adore. It makes me so happy just plugging in my earphones and going away at it and being able to present that to people. It's like, hey, this is a thing.
You know, oddly enough, I also like that.
Yeah, and it's... It's like we can't all be, this is probably not, well, it might be a pretty good reference. So Critical Role.
Okay.
Had an $11 million Kickstarter. Wow. To take what was a hobby of theirs, something they so enjoyed, has become that valuable to other people.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That is not, that's the exception. That's not the rule. That's
definitely an exception.
But it's so, they found a way to take something that they enjoy and they made it available to other people and other people found value in that. And now they have basically have a company, Critical Role, that they're able to turn into a profitable, I don't even know what you would call that because I don't know how much profit they make off of it, right? With, it just.
So that's one way to look at this. I think though, in the way he was presenting this and the way I'm trying to present it, is that you're find those tasks that you like doing at work or that you don't hate as much, I guess, is a good start, and do those. So if you like talking to customers, like it gives you this moment of meaning when you talk to them and you're like, oh, wow, our stuff really helped you, or you just enjoy that social moment, try to make that a bigger part of your work. Like talk to maybe your manager, be like, look, this is something I really appreciate doing, and I know the company needs me to do it. Is it possible for us to, like...
Rearrange the role.
Yeah, rearrange the role. Like, I honestly don't mind if... I actually like it when I get moments to do, like, really mind-numbing stuff. Not, like, answering emails, but, like, when I have to copy numbers from one chart into another. I actually like that stuff because I can put on my headphones and listen to books I like. So I use it as reading time. I'm like, I'm reading books I love at work. And I'm getting things done. So I'm doing like that bottom boring quadrant, but I've like, because I've got an audiobook, I'm like,
multitasking.
I'm in a happier place. I'm like, I'm in a happy place. Well, if I didn't have it, because I didn't do that for the first few times I did the spreadsheets and stuff, I was like, copy paste numbers.
I just, maybe what he means with this chart is as you look at your job or you look into other jobs, write down the things that you enjoy and the menial tasks and find some that are pretty broad. Like you said, customer relationships, right? Mm-hmm. Relationship building or customer focused. So put that down and then basically write a job description based on these little tasks that you're building off of this chart and then start job searching for something that matches your job description you wrote down.
Mm. I like that idea. And I think that's a really practical idea. I feel like some people are gonna try taking that for like, and run with it in the wrong way. Because I've seen so many like jokes where people are like, oh, they say dress for the job I want, so that I came in dressed as like Batman, right? That and so they're like, oh, what I like to do? I like to sleep. I know they hire people to sleep sometimes.
Sleep studies are a thing.
Yeah, but it's one of the most competitive and difficult job fields to get into.
Yeah, you have to be a good sleeper.
You have to be a great sleeper. And also even the great sleepers are like fighting each other to get the job, right?
Well, and I mean, it's also like part of this whole Uber, Lyft, what is the food delivery service? Grubhub?
Grubhub, yeah.
Like
DoorDash.
DoorDash. What do you call those? They're like gig jobs, right? So technology has put us into a point where people can have gig jobs that actually kind of did support them. Now, the market has become so flooded, I don't think you could make any real profit out of that unless you're living in, like, Hurley, Mississippi, where there's absolutely no one doing it, and you want to put in 30-minute drives to go one way, then sure. You could probably make a lot of money off of that. Pick up a couple runs and, you know, go. But, not that I've thought about it.
I was like, that was very specific.
That's oddly specific. Yeah,
that's exactly what I was thinking.
I'm
going to
end up on Reddit. I grew up there and I know how bad it is. So,
okay.
I think it's a practical, and if you're real about it and you're, like, I'm not obviously going to put down that I'm looking for data entry or data analysis.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have a whole lot of specific experience in that, right? I would need to slowly find my way onto that side.
But this is where I think this chart, it's suggesting that in your job right now, you sort of make it known and you do a good job within the data analytics you're doing right now, and people will sort of notice that, and they'll try to it'll sort of help phase you more into a data analytics portion of your position.
That's
the idea.
And it would help, I think it would help me be happier in what I do. I don't know that I would find more meaning in that.
Okay. So I've been thinking about this a little bit too, with the idea of the meaning. I know there's a lot of, you get a lot of satisfaction, not you, but like you as in a general you, as including myself. I get a lot of satisfaction from things completed, right? Checking a box off a checklist, it's mm-hmm. like, that's great. And so finding the satisfaction of a job well done, right? You might have to grind that a little bit and you might need to make sure you get it finished, but getting yourself that satisfaction. I know physical labor for me is something that's highly satisfying at the end of the day.
Physical labor,
right?
Yeah.
I worked on all those farms and such, and I used to work on a lot of landscaping and stuff. And just my favorite days were the days I would go and help my boss, and he'd have a chainsaw, and I was just carrying logs. I love carrying logs. Like when I'm at home at my family's place, and there's like logs to be carried, I'm like, yes!
Lead blankets up the stairs when I did decon.
All right. Yeah, that sounds great. I love that stuff.
In full, you're fully like you're in your gear, right? You're fully clothed up. You've got all of your hazmat suits on, basically.
Mm-hmm.
And you're just carrying lead blankets up the stairs, or we'd have to move trash, or I mean, it's just a lot of physical hard days work, and you're doing like, so I would work not power outages, but refueling outages.
Okay.
They would shut the plant down and they would refuel the rods, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so I would go in to help clean up the plant while they're doing that. And 12 hours a day, 6 days a week in Georgia, right? In basically the summer, it's either the spring or the fall, but that means it's, you know, 80 degrees. Right, yeah. No matter what you do. And I loved it. I would come home drenched in sweat, so tired, like you don't even want to shower, yeah. That kind of tired.
Exactly. Oh, man, there's so many jobs I've worked that it's been, like, working on, like, worm farms and stuff, and where just dead tired at the end of the day, but you feel great. Like
you feel so satisfied.
It's like a job really well done, and I'm wondering, how can you transition that into your life at work? Like, can you get that satisfaction of like, man, my brain is tired, but that was some good work. I got some good numbers out of that.
I don't know if there's a way. Here's my hypothesis and my suggestion. Everybody quits corporate America and we just go back to bartering and living on a farm.
I like things that come out of corporate America. I like restaurants and I like electronics and things.
You know, I'm just waiting on that one good solar flare to knock all of that out. And just, like, let me go back to being this poor country covered in dirt.
I mean, I love homesteading and working in farms and such. Like, I have a lot of that in my background, but I still kind of appreciate
technology. You still want the video games, yeah.
I like the video games, I like the movies, I like the printed press. That's a nice thing.
Well, I'm just like, I don't know if it's just life with the kiddo and husband's two dogs and all that. I was like, can we just go back to a simpler time where I wake up at dawn and take care of chickens and watch kids run around and
love it. Worry about, and all that.
Yeah, worry about the snakes and syphilis from armadillos and whatever. Yeah, let's just go back to that.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, but excluding solar flares, how do we find ourselves more happy what we're doing? Because obviously, I think my earlier point about, like, should we even bother is not really good. I think we should. Like, it's a lot of our lives are spent at work.
I think you have to find...
And we gotta find something.
Meaning and purpose in what you do. Mm-hmm. How you get there, existentially, interstitially, is that a word?
I've never heard interstitially, but I think...
But it's the opposite of existential, whatever that is. Whatever
but
that word
existential
is.
Usually happens to you inside, so
I
don't know.
Existential came from outside, but it affected you inside.
No, I don't think that's what existential means. Anyways, keep going.
Yeah, so whether you find it outside, from outside sources, or okay. if you get it from inside sources, okay. I think you have to... I like the way that was phrased better. I think you have to find purpose and meaning, however you can get it, just to keep your sanity.
Okay.
In having a 40-hour a week plus job, maintaining your life, because you are spending, you know, a third, half of your week.
Yeah, you spend so much time. Recently I looked at it and it was just your waking hours. You spend a lot of your waking hours at work.
And it's not like when you get home, you just shut it off and go to home. Like, you're still thinking about work for a good 45 minutes.
Yeah, sometimes I do. I generally try to use that time driving back to, like,
to shut it off.
Works
yeah.
over there. Though, especially with my old job, I used to be a teacher. It didn't get shut off. I just came back and I was like, ugh.
Great papers.
It just keeps going. This is the worst. That was the worst. Not very much satisfaction in that job.
But people would say that should be the most meaningful job because you're a teacher.
That's what everyone said. And I was like, I'm
telling you.
I was not happy there.
It is a trial and error process to look at the position you are currently in and say, I am going to assign this purpose and this meaning to this work that I currently do because of XYZ. And whatever XYZ is, it's because of the impact you're having on other people, because of the impact you're having on you and the way you feel about yourself, because of the impact it has on your life that you're living. Whatever it takes, you gotta find some kind of positivity in that, because if you don't, you're going to be miserable. Now, that's not to say stay at a toxic job because right. it has, you know, one of those things. That's not finding meaning, right? Don't give it meaning, right? The only meaning is that you're miserable.
Yeah, but for jobs that aren't killing you, right? Jobs that are not really terrible for you. I think we do need to find the meaning for ourselves, and I think that comes from one, recognizing what it's allowing you to do, right? Without that job, you're having some hurdles, like I couldn't support my family properly and stuff. My wife works as well, but like there wouldn't be there one income less is a lot less, right? So it facilitates that and my being able to take care of my daughter and everything, but there's a lot of value also in trying to find like meaning in those moments, right? Whether they be the moments of your like your day-to-day activities, you're completing a job well done. If I could do physical labor in my job, I'd be happy to do it sometimes. I actually, there was one day when I was teaching, and it was one of our teacher work days, but they needed us to pull carpet. I was like, best day ever, teacher work day. They had me pulling carpets instead of grading papers. I'm happy, man. But like...
Didn't have to deal with your students?
Yeah.
No, that's not it.
It was a teacher work day. It was a teacher work day. They weren't there anymore.
They weren't there anymore.
My alternative was just like writing lesson plans and grading. And I was like, I'm going to tear up some carpets. Yes! I was pulling them, and I was really tired at the end of the day, but I thought it was really great. My grip was like, that was a dead thing. I was like, my hands were like...
I used a squirt bottle to try to kill, like, weeds and grass in my flower bed, and I didn't realize how weak my grip was until I'm like, squirt, 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 squirt. And I'm like, this arm is getting tired. Use this hand. And then I have to switch fingers, and then not all the fingers are the same strength.
No,
so, like,
not.
Some of them tear... Some of them wore out so much faster. I was like, man, I got to, like... start playing piano or something to get that grip strength where it needs to be.
Any sort of thing for a sustained amount of times is rough. Like, I work out a lot, and I'm pretty fit, but, like, carrying the baby, sometimes I'm like, golly. Or, like, carrying groceries up the steps, I'm like, this is horrible. Someone who can run, like, I can run real fast. I can pick up big weights and put them back down, and this grocery bag sucks.
My 1-year-old isn't even, she's just barely 20 pounds. And there are some days I'm like, what did you eat today? Why are you so heavy?
Yeah. But
it's so great though. She's cute. It's worth it.
But we can't find those moments, right? We can't find those moments to do it. And I think it's what I just said about sustained efforts are kind of hard. Even if I'm like, you're capable of these sort of things, work just takes 8 hours of a day. And so grinding for 8 hours in the day is kind of tiring.
Yeah.
So we need to find ourselves like moments that matter in our lives and like things that we feel good accomplishing and trying to get ourselves into that upper quadrant, that doing meaningful work to your job and that you find enjoyable or at least more enjoyable than some of the other tasks you could be doing. And so there's like these various strategies, but there's also just the whole outlook. I don't know how to get the entire outlook. I've never figured that out. I wish I could, that I could just switch on that switch that and do what Martin Luther King Jr. was talking about and what the guy in Monk was talking about of like owning that job and really having that purpose, really letting it guide you.
Well, you also kind of run the risk of, and we can talk about this in the next time, because I think our next episode's mental health.
Yeah. So, yeah.
But burnout.
Burnout. And all. We're also, one of the other things we're going to talk about really soon is motivation. And like, how do you get yourself to the point where you can sustain these sort of things? But I think we're running low on time, so we should probably be wrapping it up. Yeah. I think we've done a pretty good job of wrapping up the ideas, and now we're circling back to them.
Yeah.
And so I think, just try finding that place. We don't have the answers. If we did, we'd be happy. We'd write a book, it'd sell out, and everybody would be happy.
There's a really great quote from the CEO of Microsoft, and again, please, I'm not trying to mispronounce his name on purpose, but Satya Nadella. I truly believe that each of us must find meaning in our work. The best work happens when you know that it's not just work, but something that will improve other people's lives in some way, shape, fashion, or form. I think is a really good thing to focus on. But again, that's just trying to find meaning in what you do as it impacts the world, and not necessarily as it impacts yourself.
Yeah.
So
I think that's a great place to end it. So thank you for listening. We hope you found some of this informative and entertaining. Always prioritize humans over numbers. I'm Felix.
And I'm Brooke.
And until next time. Thank you for listening to the Humans Over Numbers podcast brought to you by Milestones. If you found it informative or entertaining, please like, subscribe, or leave a comment or review. I'm your host, Felix, and until next time.